Hello and welcome to episode 13 of Upsides, talking about the NFL offseason. Let's be honest. With me today is Will Leach of New York Magazine, Deadspin's founding editor. Welcome, sir.
Of course. Thanks for having me.
For those of you who are longtime listeners of the show, the ones that go all the way back to October, we're going to do things a little different today. We have Will on. He is, of course, not just a sports writer, but also a film critic.
Pretending to be.
You know, it's enough of a hat that we're having right. You on specifically to talk about the Oscars. First half of the show, NFL headlines for you NFL fans who don't want to hear about movies. Don't worry, we're talking about the NFL up front. Back half of the show, back two-thirds of the show are going to be just the Oscars because we need something to talk about. It's a long and cold NFL offseason.
Yeah, after you hear me talk about the combine, you'll want to hear me talk about movies. I assure you.
Anything but the combine. And we see that your can is empty.
It's
now.
Empty, so that's good thing.
Let's start off with NFL offseason headlines. Just knock these out, and we'll pretend to be excited about them.
Okay. The Brady thing is interesting.
Tom Brady signed an extension that keeps him in New England until the age of 40.
Right. I didn't realize he was that old. That kind of snuck up on it, didn't it?
He's in his mid-30s now. He's going to be there through 2017.
Yeah.
I actually don't care enough about the Patriots to actually memorize the details of the deal. The story, of course, broken by SI's Peter King, who is very, very proud of himself.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I mean, you know, it's weird when King gets excited about breaking it. Because, first off, he's, like, broken so many. Like, it always seems like he gets really excited about these kind of weird insider stories.
Yeah.
He'd never break a Teo story.
No.
Like, he'd never break something like that, which is fine, but it's got a little bit of that kind of, you know, I like King a little bit more than I know than some other people do, but I certainly he always likes getting those, I have this scoop about how great Goodell is, and I have this scoop about this internal working
what
thing.
What a shock that he would break the news about Tom Brady of his hometown New England Patriots.
Yeah, exactly.
I think it's a good move. I think that Tom Brady, like, his strengths are not running around, and he doesn't get hit very often. He's an accurate thrower. He makes good decisions. He runs the offense. I think it's a good move for him.
Yeah, I think it's funny how much people have made out of, you know, him taking less money in the contract. And I don't know. I mean, I guess,
how's he going to get by with $9 million a year?
Yeah, and like, and again, I understand that, like, some people in that situation don't do that, but, like, also the way football works, it's so rare that one player has such power and such control over what that franchise does. I mean, he kind of still is the Patriots as much as Belichick is. It makes sense for him. Like, on one hand, I guess he should be applauded for it. He could have gone for more money, but, like, you don't become Tom Brady by making, like, if he had made that much money the last time he would have a contract, he would probably not make as much money now because the Patriots wouldn't have been that good over the last 5 years.
As much as I hate to use the word brand,
right.
Like, Tom Brady's brand is linked to his success going 12-4, 11-5 every single year with the Patriots. And his success, he doesn't want to be Joe Montana with the Chiefs at the end of his career.
Right. And that makes sense.
And I think that, like, in the long run, he's looking long term, and he's going to be set up better as a Patriot for life. Yeah. And
I still feel like I know it's only been a little more than a year. I still don't think we make quite enough of the scene after they lost the Super Bowl to the Giants from Brady in the locker room with Giselle and the crying and the consoling. I still feel like that should be, like, even now, we've almost forgotten it.
And
I don't know if we should.
She called out the receivers. For
It still feels like that should be a larger, we should be talking. That should have been the next line. Tom Brady, comma, the guy who had the thing in the locker. I always thought that should be a larger part of the story, but I guess we like him. As much, it's fine. Brady is, I know he's in that, like, Jeter world now but he's still so good.
Yeah.
That at a certain level, as much as you want to hate him, and you definitely want to hate the Patriots, like, you know, you certainly don't begrudge him.
He's still going to be a top quarterback at age 39.
Exactly.
Next up is hard for me to pick out what I've enjoyed most this week in terms of the NFL, because there were some fun stuff from the combine, but I think I'm gonna have to go with Desmond Bryant, the Raiders defensive tackle who was arrested this weekend. Just the mugshot is of him shirtless, and the face he's making with the tongue sticking out. He looks like a large reptile swallowing waterfowl to me.
He kind of looks like something from Pan's Labyrinth, like the creature in the basement. I feel like that's actually a pretty good representation of kind of what he looked like. We were discussing this off air, but I love the idea that, like, this, to me, I'm glad it was captured at that exact moment. Because, like, I suspect, like, look at the Nick Nolte shot. Like, you could have got that a second before or a second after. It still was going to be crazy.
Yeah.
I wonder if, like, I'm not sure exactly what happened if they just caught him. Like, I wonder if they have other copies and they're like, oh, no.
This is the one
that we're going with. Like, one, he looks, like, relatively normal. Not relative, but he's, like, his head's just cocked a little bit to the right.
Yeah.
But, like, I feel like they picked the exact right one. You were right. I have to say there are a few people in the world who I trust enough. But I had not seen the picture yet, and I saw your tweet saying, oh, this is a Hall of Fame mugshot. And I was like, you know what? I guarantee you it is. But I actually do trust your judgment on mugshots. And you were right.
You were saying before the show that the parties responsible for mugshots should make, like, animated GIFs of them.
Like, get on Vine. The sheriff's department is on Vine. Like, again, like, maybe 1 second before. If you could get, like, two Vines right next to one another, so you have 12 seconds of them going in to take the picture, and then 12 seconds afterwards, there's a story. Lifetimes
mug
are
vines.
In those. Yeah. That would be mug GIFs. That would be an excellent idea.
I would watch the really crap out of that.
Honestly. You could fund whole departments through that if they were to charge for that.
The combine for me is obviously in the news. It's finishing up shortly. For me, the combine is not about learning which players are fastest or strongest or improving or falling draft stock. What I want out of every single year is one lasting, funny, animated GIF. Last year, it was Vic Ballard mm-hmm. falling during the 40.
Mm-hmm.
This year, it was Shamarco Thomas, who ran a 4.38 successfully, but then fell as he crossed the finish line. And it just happened right before this morning, and I think we're cutting to the GIF right now. Oh, God, I could watch this all day. Yes. The old sniper shot got
it. Really is. It really is a nice touch. In retrospect, they really should not have dug that huge ditch like right at the finish line. That was just a cruel prank.
Down by a sniper. That's sad.
Do we have a disapproving Harbaugh gift compared to that?
We're gonna get it. Leanne, let's roll with Fumbler. We want to talk about Manti Te'o. Was the big story yesterday. His 4.82 was. Was disappointingly slow. They were saying that he was saying that he could run a 4.5, a 4.6. He was the 20th slowest out of 26 linebackers at the combine. He's basically no longer a first rounder, is what people are saying. And yes, you're right. John Harbaugh had the disapproving the split screen
right,
as Te'o runs the 40. Yeah. It's the animated GIF we have of John Harbaugh with the disapproving no. Yeah. And we subbed out Harbaugh for a couple different pictures. Michaela Maroney's mm-hmm. Not impressed face, grumpy cat.
But see, my argument is that you should now switch out Te'o and just have Harbaugh reacting to stupid things that people do.
That's good.
Yeah, I like that idea. Just
That's the beautiful. That's the beauty.
Probably you could put it right next to me talking right now, and he'd be like, you had a bad guest on this one, Matt.
Third round talent.
Yeah, third round. Yes, right.
We both are. It's all right. and of course, I just to combine everything, we've also got Desmond Bryant in the window.
Right. That is a nice touch.
You can never get enough of that. All right, so I think that's. Do you have any other lingering NFL issues?
Yeah, the combine. I make the same comment about the combine every year. It still feels weird to have a bunch of grown adults looking at young men in their underwear running and jumping and lifting things. It still always feels weird to me. And I know that. Listen, I know this is a football podcast, and of course I love football. I don't love football enough to watch coverage of the combine. I'm right. I look for people to fall down.
I have a football podcast, and I'm not interested in the combine enough to watch it. I caught like maybe 20 minutes on Saturday. Yeah. That was all I could really do to myself. And so let's talk Oscars. You and I both enjoy movies. I wanted you on the show specifically post-Oscars because while I love talking about the Oscars, I also don't love movies enough to see every single one. So
I did see all the movies.
Even Amour?
I did see Amour. That's one of the first ones I saw. That was on my top 10. I loved Amour. So. Loved Amour. You don't love Amour. Endure Amour and then tell people you should go endure it as well. I don't know. You don't necessarily love
it. It's a
movie.
Moving experience.
Yes.
I want to run through... I want to go through the big six.
Okay.
The
should we talk about McFarlane? I feel like
You know what? Let's start with McFarlane.
Yeah, because I've gotten somewhat of a reputation online as for being a McFarlane.
You hated Ted, of course.
Yeah, I did not like Ted at all, and I will confess I haven't watched a lot of Family Guy, but it's not really my cup of tea, to be honest. I'm of the South Park Team Manatee camp in that regard, but
I think there's nothing wrong with that. I've laughed at Family Guy before.
Right. Well, I've laughed too. I mean, like everything. Always, he's very good at like the construction of a joke.
Yeah,
and the manatees are, but.
But I think there's something where some of the humor comes from the randomness of it rather than the actual joke itself, which is fine. But I thought he was fine.
I have to say I'm not a McFarlane fan at all, and certainly like I did not like him because I didn't like him before. It surprised me if like oh my gosh he's
actually great.
He's Johnny Carson. I had no idea. That would have surprised me. I don't really think all the bits were horrible. I feel like the major problem is just he tried so much to insulate himself against criticism that you just like the great thing of course being the best example being the we saw your boobs thing, which to me I thought when they went to that segment because he introduces it as this is what we would have done. Yeah. So I thought, we're going to see like 5 seconds of this. Like a Family Guy cutaway.
Yeah.
We're going to see like 5 seconds of this and they're going to cut back and we'll be like, whoo, I'm glad he didn't do that in front of billions of people.
Yeah.
But then when he actually does it, it's like, wait, you just wanted to do the joke.
Yeah.
Like, and so I feel like I like the sock puppets of flight that actually made me laugh.
That was actually pretty good.
And I thought the Meryl Streep intro was pretty funny. I thought like, I always wait for someone to do that. But generally speaking, my issue with him as a host was the same issue I have always had with him. There's such like cynicism and insincerity to. I'm not saying that he has to go up there and like who could possibly be sincere introducing the guy of the head of the Academy.
Yeah.
Like that's not. But like there's just such insincerity and just not even smugness but like smarminess to it that that it's definitely not my cup of tea. But that said, he was better than James Franco and Anne Hathaway. I don't think there's any question about that.
I actually loved the James Franco and Anne Hathaway year just because it was. I am a bit of a James Franco fan, but
I'm too.
He was just dick-nosing the entire audience. Like,
that's true. I guess that's true. I guess I appreciated the concept more than the actual. But it's fine. Like I really feel like the most underrated Oscar host is Steve Martin. Like Steve Martin always gets that right every year because he's such a creature of Hollywood so much, but he also has like he's also a smart guy that has a somewhat healthy disdain, but in good spirit. I feel like he I actually like Letterman. I feel like Steve Martin is like the best example of a guy that he doesn't have that like snot nose look at me stuff of Billy Crystal, but like he's an older version of it that I still think works. But we'll see. I think on a certain level we just want to complain about the hosts. Like if we get Tina Fey and Amy Poehler next year, we're going to complain about them too.
You know what it is? It's essentially the same thing as we'll complain about whoever's calling the games for Monday Night Football.
Right.
Like,
exactly.
Like it's we get the thing like, oh, I can't stand Gruden. He always says this guy. It's like, do you remember Dennis Miller?
Yeah, right. Do you remember? honestly, you're right. And do you remember Joe Theismann?
Theismann.
Honestly, it's amazing how people we've forgotten just how awful Joe Theismann was.
It was so traumatic. I'd forgotten.
Yeah,
about
like Dennis Miller was bad, but Dennis Miller was Dennis Miller. But like Joe Theismann was like he was trying.
He was horrible. I never heard like he's poisoned. My least favorite commentator.
Yeah, I don't think there's really any question.
Okay. McFarlane, I'd say middle of the pack.
I go a little lower than the middle of the pack, but I think that certainly there were worse. But he's already said he's not coming back, and I don't think they would have asked him.
No, and I think that that Tina Fey and
they'd be good, and then we'll all complain about them like we always do.
Yeah, I won't.
I won't. But everyone will complain.
I have just enough sincerity left to still like things that are cool.
Of course, I realized that moment about I was on Twitter for like the first 45 minutes of the Oscars. I was man, I gotta get like there's like the woman that sang the James Bond the she was so great, but like I mean I looked over
she's
and
like 68 or 70.
She's older than that.
76.
Yeah, she's like and I looked at everyone's like. Who's this pruny old lady singing these songs? Oh, going to just die already. I was like, okay, listen. I love the internet. I love the openness of discourse, but I think I need a little bit of a break.
Yeah, people should know who Shirley Bassey is.
Yes.
And I made him, she looked like a Maya Rudolph character to me.
Yeah, so exactly. I
made the Maya Rudolph joke, and I don't regret it. That was.
I don't think there's anything wrong with that joke.
But yeah, she's
Maya Rudolph is awesome.
If my wife looks like that at 76, I'll be very lucky.
Yes.
She looks great now. Just had to say that.
Of course.
So Big Six, yes. Best Picture, Argo.
Yeah, I liked Argo. I feel like I actually was hoping Lincoln would win, because I like Lincoln more, though Zero Dark Thirty is actually my favorite movie that was nominated. But I still am like enough of an Oscar nerd that it really bothered me that it's the first time since Driving Miss Daisy in 1989 that the movie won Best Picture but did not have the
Best Director.
No nomination for Best Director, which is fine. It's not like, oh, poor Ben Affleck, he was screwed. Yeah. It's not that. It's just that like there seems – I don't like things that are inconsistent, and I don't like – and to me, one of the things that's frustrating about that is it makes sense that Driving Miss Daisy would win Best Picture but not have Best Director because that movie's kind of crappily directed. Like Bruce Barefoot is not that good of a director. Like it makes – like it's not like – like no one can name another – like good luck finding another Bruce Beresford movie. Nobody cares. He's not like a big director that people remember. But like Ben Affleck, like the direction of the movie is one of the reasons that movie's really good. Like,
yeah, absolutely.
He is a very – like he's just very kind of a muscular director. And you can tell he's a muscular director because there's always shots with him with his shirt off in his own movies. But
Doing pull-ups,
exactly. And overhead crane shots of Boston, even though that movie didn't even take place in Boston.
Iran looks a lot like
it does. Wow, it's Fenway. They're playing soccer over at Fenway. So that bothered me just because I don't like the inconsistency of it, because I feel like he actually, as a director, it's one of the best parts. One of my least favorite parts of Argo is actually him as an actor in that movie. I feel like it's a particularly kind of incurious performance. He just kind of plays hero guy.
It's everybody else's duty to do the heavy lifting.
And he's hero guy.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
And of course, the great scene at the end where they show how much all the people look exactly like the people and all the settings look exactly like the settings.
I thought that was so unnecessary.
Yeah, and then the best part is you see the guy who looks nothing like Ben Affleck at all. They're not even the same demographic.
They both have beards.
They do have both have beards. That's true. That's true.
For me, I thought the we'll get into the best director in a second. I want to say my favorite movies, my top five. I'd say Argo was like five. For
yeah,
me.
Yeah, it was 10 for me.
Django was my favorite movie of the last year. And then Looper was probably the best time I had at the movies.
Yeah, Looper was pretty great. Looper made my top 10.
Zero Dark Thirty and Silver Linings Playbook.
Okay, so three of your five made my top 10, and I liked the other two.
Yeah.
So the ones that didn't make it were Django and Silver Linings Playbook. But I was ecstatic that Christoph Waltz won.
He was fantastic.
Yeah, he is. I really think he might have been like genetically created to recite Tarantino dialogue. Like he's amazing. Perfect. Like he's absolutely perfect. I still have a few issues with that movie, mostly just like I feel like that like Tarantino gets off track sometimes. He didn't have his editor with him, so I feel like those occasional moments where he's maybe a little bit too indulgent. And I know like complaining about Tarantino movie being indulgent is I get it. But like it's like I do think the movie's really good, and Waltz is so perfect in it. Like I love the fact that basically Christoph Waltz, we've just heard of him when Inglourious Basterds came out, and now he's won two Oscars for Tarantino movies. It's pretty great,
and he's so good, and he was terrifying in Inglourious Basterds,
also Weasley and I actually like that performance a little bit more than Django, because Django I love him in Django, but he's almost just pure entertainment in Django. Like he's just it's fun to listen to him talk.
You know,
and
I thought Leonardo DiCaprio should have gotten a nod for Best Supporting too. It probably would have messed up the vote and they would have split the vote, but I thought DiCaprio was actually had a better performance than
I thought Samuel Jackson was really good in it too.
Any of the other nominated actors.
And to me, like another smaller issue I have with that movie is I feel like DiCaprio is awesome, but like he's also kind of an empty villain in a lot of ways. I don't want to give spoilers, but but like it's the movie like it almost has this Spielberg problem of ending like three or four times, and so I feel like it's almost like yes, we have to get rid of this bad guy, and we have to get rid of this bad guy.
Yes,
it doesn't quite build up as much as you'd like it to. But that said, like I it's great. It's a very entertaining movie. Waltz actually he's probably my favorite of all the people in that movie, but just because he's just so entertaining. It's weird. I saw him in Water for Elephants with Reese Witherspoon and Twilight.
Yeah, I saw about half an hour of
that. And it's so weird to be like oh, that's right. Tarantino doesn't write your dialogue for everything. it's not that he's like bad in the movie, but it's just
he's just
a normal person.
By the way, it would have been way better if it had been a Tarantino movie.
Oh, that would have been pretty awesome. that would have built up to something great. But
I'm happy that Tarantino got the award for best original screenplay.
Yeah, I was happy about that too. I think it's fine. Like even though Django is not one of my, it's probably not in my top half of favorite Tarantino movies, but I really enjoy all of them. So I'm a fan. So I'm a fan. So to see him win it made me pretty happy. And all, and the only thing that really annoyed me about Tarantino this whole kind of Oscar season was when he disparaged Death Proof, which is actually, this is half of Grindhouse, which I love. I feel like that, like he said it was probably his least favorite movie of his. He is totally wrong. Like, Death Proof is great, and it's Tarantino in like a different kind of realm than what he usually does. So, but it was great to see him win, and you know, cocaine, you know.
More Oscar acceptance speeches should end with peace out.
Yeah, I think, I gotta tell you, you can make a pretty strong argument that 3-4 people that won may have pretty obviously been under the influence of cocaine. Oh, yeah. And not even the wizards. Like, not even the white-haired wizards.
The wizards.
Yeah, with their van with the unicorn on the side. But I don't even think those were the coke guys. But it was pretty obvious there was some cocaine going on in that show.
Yeah,
it's back. It's back in L.A., I guess.
I want to talk about also Jennifer Lawrence, because she's my favorite person on the entire planet.
Yeah, she did herself a lot of favors with her press stuff this entire time.
She was amazing.
So she did something great every single time. And to me, like, I mean, I've talked about the Jack Nicholson thing afterwards, but I mean, it was perfect. Like, it's exactly what you want. It actually made me like Jack Nicholson a little bit more than I had in a while. Like, okay, he's creepy, but like playfully creepy. Yeah. Whereas I thought he actually had devolved into like weird, gnarly creepy.
Yeah.
And and I really like her in that movie. I think I really enjoyed her winning for that movie.
She was actually my favorite. I think she had, Jessica Chastain was really good in Zero Dark Thirty, but I think, of course, Oscars love anybody playing someone who's mentally ill. But I thought, despite that, she was fantastic. I thought David O. Russell deserved a little bit more credit for Best Director, maybe.
Yeah.
Because in anyone else's hands, that's a really lousy rom-com.
Yeah, right.
Like, that could be...
He's edgy and he's jittery enough to actually make that kind of work a little bit.
Yeah.
And it's funny, I think that, like, I think you'd also make an argument. There's a few things I feel like don't quite work in that movie. But on the whole, like, both of I think Bradley Cooper's really good in that
He's
movie.
He's excellent.
And one of the things I like about him too is one of the same reasons I like John Hamm in a lot of ways. They're like these really kind of conventional, handsome actors who really struggled for like a long time and got their break relatively late in life, late in the life of an actor.
Yeah.
And I think of chosen the right things to do with it, have not done like the way the dumb things. You don't see, you know, him doing Taylor Lautner's Abduction movie. Like, you see them like making smart decisions because they're not getting so popular so young that they're making dumb things. And I really like that. I was really impressed by him. And I knew Jennifer Lawrence was good, and I figured Bradley Cooper was okay. He was actually a lot better in that movie than I thought he was going to be.
I would have liked to have seen Jennifer Lawrence win for Winter's Bone, which she was amazing.
Oh, she's awesome. And it's funny now too, because now, like, she's obviously not glamorous in that movie, but like to see her like play these kind of like glamour characters just as well, and also to see her, like, I'm a little worried about, because I mean, she's what, 22?
Yeah.
And like, there's like the road is littered with people we have loved at 22 and thought were perfect and have found something to dislike about them and discard them. So I really hope that like this is about as peak as an actress can possibly get in her life and career.
Yeah.
Like, not only winning an Oscar, but like being the head of this major $1 billion franchise at the Hunger Games.
Did you watch her press conference?
Oh yeah.
One of the journalists asked her, like, are you like having this much success this early? Yeah. Like, are you concerned about like peaking too early? Right. She's like, well, now I am. Thanks.
Right. Exactly. And then she's right, because we're the ones that are going to do it.
Yeah.
Like, we're the ones that are going to do it. And I don't think it's like she's suddenly going to turn into Howard Hughes and be like, I'm so famous and popular and rich and hiding in a bathroom somewhere. She's not going to do anything, but we'll do it. Like, this is what we always do. So was there a time where Anne Hathaway was really beloved? And because now, of course, people turn on her all the time.
I actually don't. I
like Anne Hathaway.
I do, too. Yeah. I do. The problem with her is that she acts like every single theater major anyone has ever known.
Yeah.
And
certainly when she does stuff like It Came True, like that's fuel for the haters, without question.
It is. And like,
I'm sorry, I just said haters.
It's
I'm sorry.
Please move to the left, haters.
I know, I'm sorry. I
think she's a great actress. I think she's attractive. I have no qualms. I love the musical Les Mis. I'm not going to see the movie.
Okay.
That
was another Seth MacFarlane joke that I liked. That was not from the Oscars, from his Twitter. He's like, no, I love Les Mis, but I love Les Mis the play, but I really wanted to have people right in my face screaming it at me. And I think that's pretty much exactly what Les Mis the movie is. And some of it works and some of it doesn't. But yeah, I feel like the thing about Anne Hathaway is Rich Jesuiak from Gawker made a great
point.
Who's
great, by the way.
Yeah, and made a great point to me about her. He's like, she's an actress who does what she's told, and she does it really well. And I think you can kind of see that, particularly in Les Mis, where she basically, like, you know, she she has she's not in the movie very long, obviously, mm-hmm. and but like she's there to nail her solo.
Yeah,
and she nails her solo. And I feel like the same thing you see that with Dark Knight Rises. Like, play, she's better in that than I think anyone thought she was going to be.
Yeah, absolutely.
And but there's
although for that whole that series of Batman, yeah. like it has been marked by weak female performances.
Oh yeah, yeah.
And when it's a huge step up from Maggie Gyllenhaal, who in turn was a huge step up from Katie Holmes.
It's weird. It's hard to remember that Katie Holmes was in that first movie. How embarrassing, by the way, that they just didn't ask her back for the second one. Like, this was like a huge hit, and obviously like she's the same character. Like, yeah. they're just like, we're casting it because, I mean, come on, you saw the movie, right? She's not good. And I feel like that was a pretty bad term. And people forget, there was a time where Katie Holmes was the before Tom Cruise, frankly, she was the up-and-coming star. She was great in Wonder Boys. I remember loving her in Wonder Boys.
She's pretty good.
She's fine, Wonder Boys.
She's good. Yeah. She never had that winner's bone performance.
She never had. I think, but there was a time where you thought she was going to have Michelle Williams' career.
Yeah.
And then, obviously, she completely dominated her. So I forget. Even that Michelle Williams is in that Oz movie.
She's
like Linda the Good Witch. I totally missed that. So
she's also this is completely off topic now, but dating Jason Segel.
Yeah, I saw that. Yeah, that seems. I don't know. I mean, like. That seems. It makes a little bit of sense. Physically, it doesn't make sense.
She needs laughter.
Yeah, exactly.
She's always. You know what? She's always so serious.
Yeah, exactly. Who among us does not? So she gave like a really great performance in the movie last year called "Take This Waltz."
I did not see that.
Which was written and directed by Sarah Polley and had Seth Rogen.
Oh. Okay.
And actually, a pretty good performance for him too. Sarah Silverman was in as well. But it's a drama with those characters, and she's great in that movie. And it's also gleefully Canadian. They think it's Canadian. like it's such a silly movie. She falls in love with this guy next door who is literally a rickshaw driver, like who rides his rickshaw hunkily with his shirt off, and the movie is still good.
It's not even like a bicycle rickshaw.
No, it's a rickshaw.
Those do not exist in Canada.
I've not spent as much time.
Actually, I haven't been to Canada recently. It's entirely possible.
That may be a big thing. I don't know.
All right,
rickshaw.
We got Daniel Day-Lewis.
We have that category, right?
Oh, yeah, sure. Who's going to touch Daniel Day-Lewis?
Yeah. I like that he's funny. That made me very happy.
It was nice.
Let's not forget, too, that like Daniel Day-Lewis took a year off to be a cobbler. This is still one of my favorite Daniel Day-Lewis stories. He wasn't even trained for a role. He literally was like, you know what? I'm going to cobble for a year. Like, Daniel Day-Lewis is, I always think of that Chuck Klosterman piece about Val Kilmer a few years ago where he talked about how Val Kilmer was more advanced in a lot of ways. Daniel Day-Lewis is working at a different level than the rest of us are. He is acting otherwise. I think he understands something about humanity that we can. And now he's going to disappear and not show up again for like 4 years and then like win another Oscar playing a frog or something.
Yeah. I'd like to see Daniel Day-Lewis in a Tarantino movie. That'd be
something. That would be fun to watch. It was funny. It reminded me.
I just read this Vanity Fair article, actually, and Daniel Day-Lewis was up for one of the roles in Pulp Fiction.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Because they just had the oral history.
It was fantastic. I recommend it. And then I had to, like, I read it, and then I was like, I have to watch Pulp Fiction now.
Was he supposed to play Vincent Vega?
I think he was up for Vincent Vega,
Travolta is kind of perfect in that.
He is.
Day-Lewis may actually be too smart.
Yeah.
To play Vincent Vega, but I'd love to see it. You know, so I always remind the two that the Django was written for Will Smith.
And wow, I'm glad that wasn't the case.
I think it would have been kind of interesting. I like Jamie Foxx. I still feel like Jamie Foxx is a little. He's fine in the role, but like, there's nothing special about him in the role.
I don't really like Jamie Foxx. I thought he was fine.
Yeah, he was fine. He's everything fine. Yeah. But like, I love because I was. Tarantino said he wrote it for Will Smith, and I love that. I love what he was trying to do with that idea. He wanted someone that you instantly. You know, sympathize with it would not. It would have been fun to see Will Smith.
Actually, that probably would have been really good.
Go with it, to really like, because I feel like I feel like Will Smith is 7 pounds was so terrible, and he's kind of like he's making another sequel and the weird Shyamalan movie. Like he's getting kind of close to Cruise Country a little bit right now.
Yeah,
and so it would have been nice to like rein him back because I actually think Will Smith is. Of underrated actor when he like is on his game, but he's getting a little off track. He's a little bit too busy running his kid's career, so it would have been nice to see him kill in the Tarantino movie.
All right, I think that about covers it for the Oscars. Let's go to a couple reader questions. This is the troll bag, as always. And first up, we kind of covered this a little bit, but Mark wrote in to say, Oscar host, for me, McFarlane decimates Billy Crystal. Please ask Will if A, he agrees, and B, he knows where babies come from. Let's skip B and focus on A. Do you agree that McFarlane is better than Crystal?
Thank you for skipping B. I'm starting to sweat. I think he's better. He was better than Crystal last year. Yeah. I don't think he was better than Crystal in the back in like the 90s, like the early 90s. But Billy Crystal still was somewhat relevant as an actor and somewhat engaged with the world as it was. Now he's so kind of like he's like Gollum with his precious. He wants his hosting gig so bad. They even kind of look alike.
They do.
And so I feel like well, I may not be a big Seth MacFarlane fan, but he's more relevant to the world of movies now than Billy Crystal is. So yeah, I think he was better than Billy Crystal last year, but I don't think he was better than like original
Billy Crystal. I think vintage Billy Crystal.
Vintage Billy Crystal
is pretty good.
Right.
And for me, like Billy Crystal at his best and still youthful would be almost in the ballpark of Steve Martin.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, and remember, I still like Letterman. I still actually think Letterman was funny.
I thought he was fine.
It was too weird to do it more than one year. Like, he's never going to be...
Same with... I actually loved Chris Rock.
Yeah, I thought Chris Rock was good. I thought Jon Stewart was good. I really enjoyed Jon Stewart's show. I thought Ellen DeGeneres was fine, but I was in the minority on that one, too. So
I actually didn't mind her.
Yeah, I thought she was fine.
But for a lot of people, the blubbering and stuttering was...
Yeah, and by the end, she definitely seemed, like, smaller. She seemed to have shrunk a little bit by the end of that show. It's a tough gig, to say the least.
But yes, people stuttering and stammering their way through things is right in your wheelhouse.
It is right,
Mr. Woody Allen.
And Mr. This Podcast.
Up next, Mets Chick, we all know Metsy, says, who was best dressed or worst dressed? Hashtag, yes, I'm a girl. I don't really even know how to answer this. But
yeah, I do kind of miss the days as a guy, forgive me, of it feels like cleavage is not as big of a thing as it used to be.
Yeah, even Salma Hayek had him under wraps.
Yeah, and maybe that's the natural flow of fashion these days, and maybe this is the difference between this and the Grammys. I don't know, but certainly it seems like cleavage is not that big of a thing.
That's a damn shame, sir.
Yeah. Even at the Emmys, Amy Poehler was like... She was heavily cleavaged. Cleavaged eyes. Cleavage-dumbed.
The décolletage was...
That's it. I guess that wasn't really a big thing this year. So.
Yeah, I would say Heidi Klum did it right. She. I don't have that picture on hand, but
have it right here in my wallet.
Worst dressed. I was disappointed with Jennifer Lawrence not wearing something tight and low cut.
You wondered if she was going to go like the way that Scarlett Johansson did that one year, she just showed up and was like, wait, wow, Scarlett Johansson looks like that now.
Yeah.
Like, it just kind of, like, came out of nowhere.
Yeah.
And you thought she might do that. But also, she was going to win. And maybe she doesn't want to go that... Like, clearly, Scarlett Johansson at one point made the decision. If you look at her in, like, Ghost World, like, clearly, at one point, she made a decision, I'm going to be a sex pot now.
Yeah.
And Jennifer Lawrence has not made that decision, and more power to her.
When she does, I will be behind her 100%. Last question. Brian said, if a movie wins Best Picture and the director isn't even nominated, does that mean the movie was the best despite the director? And we kind of talked about this a little bit.
I think it's just a dumb mistake by the Academy, to be honest. It's funny to think, too, that... If Affleck would have gotten nominated, if he would have snuck in, like, he would have been a slam dunk winner. Like, I think Argo would have maybe even stole more categories than it did.
Yeah.
Because it would have had there was still a little bit of uncertainty just because he wasn't nominated for Best Director. Was Argo really going to break that years long pattern? But I think if Affleck would have gotten nominated, I think Argo might have had a clean sweep through a ton of stuff from the night. Just because what would have won more technical awards, just because it would have it's Argo's night. It's going to win everything.
Yeah.
So.
The Academy is so weird. And again, I want to close the show, but I want to talk about, probably should have done this up front, but people are like, oh, the Oscars, it doesn't mean anything. In fact, it was the brainchild of, I forget who it was in Hollywood, but like came up with the award ceremony as a way to like pacify the actors and pay them less.
That's how everything in every field started.
But it makes
the labor less.
But it makes sense to that if you watch movies, if you like movies, then it makes perfect sense that you want the most esteemed awards to go. You want your opinions justified.
I think you can make a pretty strong argument against all award shows, certainly, except for the ESPYs, of course. but you can make a strong argument against all award shows. But I do feel like I still feel like the Oscars is the best of them. If you were to compare the Oscars to like the Grammys, like if the Oscars nominated movies the way that Grammys nominate. Like Transformers would get nominated, and like whatever the bit, Twilight would get nominated. Like clearly there is at least the illusion. They're at least trying to honor halfway decent movies. And obviously there's like there's
going
to be
Emmys. I think the Emmys are the worst because they're caught in the crossfire of acknowledging which shows are the most popular and which ones are the best. Like you always have like The Big Bang Theory for best comedy and like Parks and Rec.
And yeah, and they have like weird random things like for some reason they just like they don't like the Mad Men actors. Like John Hamm's never won.
Yeah.
Like there's all kind of like weird kind of like things. And I feel like the Oscars, like, they don't get a lot of things right either. Like I think they missed a lot of stuff this year.
Well, it's they're all very old and very white.
Yeah. It really was shocking. Someone had the stats that like the median age is like 63.
Median age is 60. And it's something like 87% white.
I mean, it's a wonder that stuff that a lot of the movies that snuck in did.
Yeah.
It's a wonder that they even got as right as they did. But I still feel I feel like they're better than the other ones just because like you know I mean say what you will, but if you were to go to Rotten Tomatoes or go to Metacritic and look at the top 10 movies ranked as compiled by critics or audience scores, you're going to see Lincoln. You're going to see Zero Dark Thirty. You're going to see Argo. Like, it's not like they just random. It's not the People's Choice Awards.
And yes.
And I do like that. I do like that.
I agree. Well, that's our thoughts on the Oscars. Oh, also, we talked about football today.
Yes. Did we? I'd forgotten.
Yes. Next week, be sure to tune in. We've got Von Miller from the Denver Broncos.
Oh, nice.
And
talk to him about Amore.
I'm sure he's seen it.
He'll just start crying right here.
His name is Will Leach. You can follow him at William F. Leach. His writing appears on New York Magazine and Deadspin.com, which you founded. He's great. Love him. And we'll see you next week. Have a good one.